Hello everyone, and welcome to my channel. If you don't know me yet, my name is Emily and I make custom dolls. Nice to meet you. Spooky season is here and it's time to present you my Halloween special. This year I joined the Haunted Circus collab hosted by Diamondza Craft, and together with other doll artists we created a real doll circus. Every doll we got has its unique role in the team, so make sure to check them out too. I chose to make a musician, and my main inspiration source was the German gothic band Lacrimosa. On their logo and album covers you will see a sad clown with a violin. According to the band itself, this image has a double meaning, such as bringing happiness to people, but also be able to speak about dark feelings like grief, fear, loneliness, and find strength in them. And that's something you literally can hear in their music, like the voices sound like a cry, but it's not a desperate cry. There's always some hope and determination to fight for the light in the end of the tunnel. And that's something I wanted to portray with this doll as well. So let's get started. I decided to keep this project in black and white tones, which is the classic set clown color palette, so I chose a Gulia doll as a base. She has grey skin and emotional face mold. I'm going to reroute her head with white hair, so I'm going to paint her scalp white to make sure the skin won't shine through the hair. Originally I wanted to style her hair into two buns and cover them with nets and beads like ballerinas usually wear, so I had to reroute a new split all the way along her scalp. You can reroute the split with more hair and then split it in half, but I prefer to do it in two steps. I would rather take less hair and do one side first, fix it in a ponytail, and then reroute the other half, placing the hair in the same holes. I think it makes it easier to split the hair evenly and have a better understanding of if it's enough hair you are plugging or not. I also didn't want to use too much hair because it would make it harder to style. To be honest, in the end I still didn't manage to make nice space buns and kept it as ponytails. Next time I want to make space buns, I would rather use acrylic hair instead of nylon because it's softer and easier to style. But what's done is done. Let's move on to the face up. I actually made two different face ups for her, but I'll show both because there were some interesting lessons to learn as well. So, in my first face up I wanted to go for more shy and sensitive look, so I decided to use a bit of blush on her cheeks and ears, and the key elements of her face up had to be the gothic eyeliner and the dramatic eyebrows I picked from Pierrot masks. Pierrot is a character from French-Italian comedy, a heartbroken poet, who is also called a father of mimes. I'll speak about him a bit more later on, because Italian comedy was my other great source of inspiration for this project. In my first face up I also tried to use some color, like this dark blue eyeshadow. In general I was quite happy with this face up, however a few layers later this eyebrow started bugging me for some reason. Like up close it looked interesting and fun, but from the distance it looked like some random sticks on her forehead. I decided to take the risk and try remove them with acetone, but because all of the blush and shadows on her face are blended into each other, acetone created weird empty spots on her face. So I had to remove all of the blush with acetone, including in between her eyeliners. And it worked! Next, I sealed her face with MSC and restored her blush. Then I tried to draw the new eyebrows, this time white to match her hair, and didn't like it again. Doing the acetone trick second time would also mean even more paint and sealant build up on her eyes and lips, and I didn't want that, because it would make the face look messy, so I had to remove the whole face up and start over. I really liked how her eyes turned out though, so it was quite painful, but as people say, beauty requires sacrifices. The second face up went way quicker than the first one though, because now I knew exactly what I wanted and I didn't waste my time on sketching with grey and trying things around, and went all the way in with that black pencil and pastels. I left out pink and blue and made the whole thing monochrome. Sometimes I take pigment from watercolor pencils with a brush and apply it like paint to get more saturated lines, but this time I thought, well, if I use watercolor pencils this way, why not just use watercolor? And I did, and I really liked it. Actual watercolor has way more pigment to it, it doesn't leave any texture on the surface and like acrylic paint does, and it's also reversible, just like watercolor pencils. Like, if you are not happy with some lines, you can correct their shape or just remove them with a clean wet brush, when for example acrylic paint doesn't leave much room for mistake. You can also seal your watercolor with MSC and it will become water resistant. To a limit, of course, but you will be able to add more layers without damaging it. I figured she looks the best without eyebrows, so instead of them I highlighted the muscle tension on her forehead a bit more to make it look like the character actually has some inner conflict going on. It is the first time when I like the eyes from my first attempt more, because the old irises looked more glowing and the eyeliner looked more gentle. Now it looks more like she's playing in the band Kiss, but in general it still looks better than the option with the eyebrows in my opinion. I don't understand why it bothers me so much if she will be wearing a mask anyway. Now the face up looks pretty decent and we can move on to the outfit. As usual, I'm going to use the pattern I made for Donna Beneviento and adjust it. If you are a new viewer and don't know how to make a basic pattern, go check out that video. For this doll, I want to make a dress with corset and deep V-neck. I also combined the chest and waist darts to reduce the amount of seams. I would like to give her dress puffed sleeves with a slit in the middle. When you add gathering to your sleeves, don't forget to add some fabric above and below the gathering to compensate for the length change from the puff. Like here, I made the first layer of the sleeve normal and the upper layer is puffed. The gathering pushes the upper layer up, creating the puff, and therefore it needs more fabric there to be the same length, if it makes sense. And I also combined the front and back halves of the dress into one piece by connecting the shoulder seams. While doing that, I left a bit more space between them right above the arms to compensate for the thickness of the seam allowances in this spot. Because of the small scale, this amount of fabric will work like shoulder pads and push the dress up a little. I think the dress sits well now, but the seam allowances are so thick, they are kinda pushing her dress off her shoulders. So now I have to cut them a bit more and see what happens. It might look like I cut almost nothing, but for a doll it's actually a lot of material, and now the dress will sit properly. Now I need to make the skirt. My first plan was to make something like a dome-shaped skirt, and I came up with an idea to use a foam ball, sketch the skirt on it, and then use the sweep as a pattern. It's interesting how you never know when some random stuff will suddenly be useful. I had these balls laying here for almost 4 years with no use, and then boom. That's why I never throw stuff away.
What? I love garbage.
I would like to add more details to the skirt using lace. I have this beautiful sample here, it's very fine and soft to the touch, but most important, it has these pattern elements that are similar size with my skirt pieces. I need to cut out 4-5 of these and attach them to the skirt. I couldn't decide which side looked the best, but in the end I settled with the flower side, because it looked more gentle and uplifting to me. And the other way around, it looked more gloomy, like a gothic cathedral, which is also beautiful. And how am I supposed to choose when there is no wrong choices? And then I made a mesh underskirt to keep the dress puffy. When working with this type of mesh, I prefer to use transparent strands because they make seams less visible. When the dress was done, I kinda liked how the skirt was hanging like flower petals, and it was matching the flower motifs, so I decided to keep it that way instead of creating a more stable dome-shaped structure as I first wanted. And I made just a simple gathered underskirt. But if you want your skirt to actually look like a sphere, you will need to at least add a second layer of gathering to the top of your underskirt, but make it short, so that its edge and volume will support the top of the sphere, or even add one or two wire circles to it to make it super stable. Next, I need to make a pair of mesh tights for her, and here I wanted to try something new as well. Like usually, monster high tights have one seam in the middle and then two seams going all the way along their legs up into the belt. And I wanted to make it a bit different, like still have the leg seams on the back so that they are still invisible from the front, but make them meet under her butt. What I wanted to achieve with it is the reduction of fabric on her waist and buns, because I already had two layers of the upper skirt and the gathered puffy underskirt there. My new design has a little flaw as well, because all the seams are meeting in one spot and will create a lump there. But I hope to hide it in her butt crack. And because the seams will be placed under her butt, these tights can be worn with a pencil skirt, for example, and the butt will look smooth. For the same reason, I decided to not add an elastic to the top. My mesh is good quality and it's stable enough to keep its form without any additional support. I personally like this new design a lot more than the old one because it looks more neat on the doll. The only thing I didn't like is that now I had to sew the middle seam by hand. But again, I'm sewing like 80% of things by hand anyway because my sewing machine hates small pieces, so who cares? Sometimes I find it even quicker to do things by hand because in that case I don't have to redo as much. I also made a pair of mesh sleeves or mittens to cover her arms. Turning out the small pieces is usually quite challenging, but I am here to help you with this struggle. You can do it real fast if you use my tip with a straw. I only had this big glass straw near me, so I used this one, and it's fine because elastic mesh is like a size queen among fabrics, but in general it's better to have a normal, average size plastic straw for these purposes, of course. I think it's a really good tip.
Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned.
Follow for more tips. Thank you. Next up is her belt. I use the same pattern I used for the dress, but make it a little bit looser because it has to go on top of the dress. This time I would like to glue the seam allowances to the belt with special glue for textile, because I don't want to have any texture from the seams on its surface. It will also protect the cuts from fraying and help the belt keep form. I rarely use glue in sewing because I was taught that using glue is a cheap way to handle things in the fashion industry. However, I think anything that makes your garment look better works. Besides, I use the textile glue and it will stay even after a few washes. As if dolls ever wash their clothes. But again, you never know what can happen. Better safe than sorry, right? The glue has to dry for at least 6 hours and then I seal it with a hot iron, without steam. Then I need to add metal rings for the lacing. I didn't have fitting rings in silver, but I had this silver chain with relatively flat links. I also like that they have this oval shape, perfect for a ribbon. Looks cute, but we are not done yet. As a last touch, I'd like to make her a ruffle collar, like the ones people used to wear in the 17th century. And this trim worked surprisingly well for this purpose. I think I can't call it lace because it's something more like embroidery, so I'll just call it a trim. I start with gathering it on a single thread, just to create the general shape first and see how much of this trim I actually need to make the full circle of even folds around her neck. Afterwards, I will stitch every fold to the next one to secure them in place and add a button. I really like how these folds turned out, it doesn't look like I just repurposed another human accessory. It actually looks like it was designed for dolls. The ugly oversized flower went away, but the other elements created this interesting, lightweight but stable structure. And it also looks good when it's upside down. The only thing I didn't notice at first is that it looks a bit yellowish from time because it's vintage and it's cotton, but I think I can accept it in exchange for that amazing looking shape. Besides, I really like vintage stuff because all vintage items have their own history and it feels like they have a soul on their own. And if we imagine that this doll is a ghost of a musician, her collar could be one of them possessed items she got attached to, and the collar looks warmer than the rest of her outfit because it is the only item from the physical world. And yes, I just made it up. But it sounds like a good background story, doesn't it? I mentioned before that my biggest source of inspiration for this project was Italian opera and carnival, so I definitely wanted to make her a Venetian mask. But the question is, how? I thought if I make the mask out of epoxy completely, it will be too bulky. If I shrink the doll's head, I could wear another doll's face on her as a mask, like I did with Hone Onna. But this mask would be too soft for me to sculpt the textures on it. And then I remembered that I still have a plastic mask from Create Your Monster doll. But when I looked at it carefully, I felt like it's still too big. As usual, the answer was on the surface. Why not harvest that Create Your Monster doll's face itself? It's made of plastic, so I can modify it, and it's certainly smaller than the other options I had. I investigated the head and found out that there's two metal screws holding the eye mechanism in place and they might be in the way if I cut the head too close to her face. So I decided to cut it in half along the factory seam first. I prefer cutting plastic with a hot knife and basically melt it rather than cut it. This way I don't have to apply much physical force, and it's also safer for my fingers because the head is quite slippery. And I definitely don't want to use an electric saw on such an unstable item, especially if there is a risk to hit the metal screws. So there is no need to hurry, we still need these fingers for sculpting. It was also interesting to learn how the eye mechanism works. I'll put it in a box in case I need it in the future. Like, I didn't know this head will ever be useful, but now it becomes a mask. I'm not sure about the eyes, but the spring definitely has potential. Could make a jack in the box, for example. When I'm done removing all the extra parts, I cut the face more precisely. The melted edge looks quite ugly, but I'll refine it with a knife later on and sand it down with sandpaper. And to make sure the mask is safe for a doll to wear, I use acetone to melt the plastic and smooth up all of the sharp edges I couldn't reach with a Dremel. And after all of the melting and sanding and melting and sanding again, I can finally add all of the fine details using epoxy sculpt. I had a lot of back and forth with this project because I had a lot of ideas and struggled to stick to one concept. Like, on one hand, I wanted to make a Lacrimosa-inspired set clown since last summer, but on the other hand, I thought it might not be spectacular enough for a circus. So I thought about transforming my set clown concept into a dancer instead. And I actually started making a dancer, and she was supposed to be wearing this mask. That's why I gave it all these festive flower elements, and I planned to paint it white, black, red, and gold as well. But while I was working on the outfit, these two concepts started to conflict in my head, and I couldn't choose one, so I switched back to the sad clown. My main inspiration for the dancer concept was Harley Quinn, a character from Italian theater. And in the story, Harley Quinn is a more light-hearted, outgoing, and cunning person. And Pierrot, the first prototype of a sad clown, is a shy and romantic guy. And he becomes a sad clown because the girl he loved chose Harley Quinn over him. And I think that Pierrot is someone more relatable to me personally. But I think I would still like to make a dancing Harley Quinn in the future, if you are interested to see it and learn a bit more about the story of Harley Quinn, of course. Tell me in the comments what you think. final touch, I'd like to decorate the faceplate with petals. For petals, I'm using this fabric that is similar to canvas but has a velvet finish on one side. It's quite stiff and is not fraying, so the petals will keep the form well. I decorate the petals with lace as well, but this lace is quite thick and on the petals it looks more like embroidery. And for the edges I got this thing called French wire, which is basically a very fine spiral, and when you attach it to fabric you can hide all of the stitches in between the wires and keep them invisible. I think it will look good, but also add additional support to the petals, because it's still a metal wire, right? So we can shape it a little bit as well. I bought this wire from Amazon just to try out and see how it works, so it's not the best quality and quite stiff, but later on I bought a silver plated and gold plated versions of this, which is a bit more expensive, but is much softer and more gentle. In this case, the stiff wire from Amazon works better though, because it keeps its form much better. And afterwards I fill up empty spaces with black rhinestones to make the mask look more festive. And now I can finally glue them to the mask. Here I use a different type of glue, it's called glue for jewelry, but honestly I don't know what kind of glue it is exactly. Like, it's pretty smelly and it melts acrylic paint, but it's really good for gluing synthetic materials. After fixing the petals, I also glued some mesh to the eye openings to make the mask look more mysterious. I wasn't sure if I should add the bells, but the mask looked kinda empty without them. I think the petals needed some more light colored elements as well. I think the mask is my favorite element of this project because it gave the doll some more character and she feels kinda dangerous with her face being completely hidden. And last but not least for today is her violin. I think a violin fits the set clown the best because its sound reminds me of a cry or even scream, and its music sounds really dramatic. At first I need to make a sketch of the violin and I use a reference photo to get the proportions right. Then I trace it on the wood. Unfortunately, my wood was not thick enough, so I had to compose violin out of two pieces. But I think it's not a problem, because the scene will be well covered with all of the other details. I actually like working with wood. It's relatively soft, easy to sand, and feels warm to hold. Why does it sound so weird again?
Stop it. Get some help.
I'm going to make the neck out of two separate pieces of wood, one for this black element that's hanging over the main body and another one for this lighter piece with a scroll in the end. I start with the bottom layer that has a bit more complex form, so I think it's easier to use wood for the base and then sculpt the details with epoxy. I know the scroll looks more like dog poop now, but it's not done yet. I only made the rough shape to have a solid piece before I sculpt smaller details. It's always easier to paint such things before you build it together, so I paint the upper part of the neck black first. And for the violin itself, I'm going to mix acrylic paint with varnish to make it more transparent, because I only need to add some tint to the wood so we can still see its texture. Using liquids on wood usually gives it goosebumps, so after applying the first layer of my tinted varnish, I sand the whole thing to make it smooth again. I kinda like how it makes the wood look shabby, I think it's cute, but not for today's project. Do you think my finger suffered enough today to become a saint? I think I'll name it Joseph now, because Joseph was also a carpenter. I cheated with the strings a little bit because there was not enough space in the neck to place four separate wires for every string, but visually it doesn't make a big difference in the scale. And at last, I need to make a bow for the violin, and then we will finally be able to see the end result pictures. I didn't count how many hours of work went into this doll yet, but that was one hell of a project for me. My favorite parts to make were the mask and the violin, but I also like how the collar turned out. Its structure looks really interesting. Another interesting fact is that she can easily hold her violin thanks to the puffy collar and the leather piece I've added to the violin. It has a good grip on the mask and doesn't let the violin fall down. Which part was your favorite? Share your thoughts in the comment section. I would like to thank Diamondza Craft for the opportunity to participate in this amazing collab. Every artist did their best to deliver good content for you, so definitely check out their videos. You can find the links in the description box. And if you like this video, don't forget to click the like button. It will make me happy and help my channel grow. If you like, you can also support my channel further by buying me a coffee. For every 100 coffees I reach, I'll make a giveaway and the winner will get a custom doll commission. Each coffee equals one entry. Thank you very much for spending your time with me today, and I hope to see you soon in my next video. Bye!